on the referee's whistle.
And here we go. Split shots are going to get to the ball first, and Chris Hammersley's going to get it. But immediately, the Corgoyles in white take it back. Looking around, and Nick McLean takes a shot right off the bat. Split shot's going to pull it around the outside, but Corgoyles take it right back.
Corgoyles looking just to find that opportunity to make that shot happen. Hailing out of Seattle for the most part. West Coast team versus a South Central team.
Yeah, the only truly Southern team, even though they are from across different parts.
Yeah, the split shots, Texas, Florida, and Kentucky.
Bike polo played all over the world, but has a few hotbeds, specifically Seattle and New York, where the sport originated about 10 years ago. Even though this sport is 100 years old, this form is only 10 years old.
Exactly.
There, Sterling taking a shot.
Taking a shot, going off of, I believe, a defensive player. I must have gone off of an offensive player, as the split shots will keep possession when the ball goes out of play. Possession is awarded to the side that did not lose the ball out of play.
Just like basketball, can't touch it last. Now here comes split shots, trying to get some offense. See a little bit of that pivot there. Nice strong shot! Chris Hammersley is going to find the back of the net.
Chris Hammersley will find the back of the net every time. Erica just let that go through her bottom bracket there.
Good speed on it. Nice slap shot. If you notice, Chris was pivoting, using that to get his position before he shot. Now here come Corgoyles in white, trying to get one of their own now that they're down. You have Quinn coming behind, Sterling Quinn that is. But he's gonna give it away, trying to pass. So now split shots come, trying to create some space up the court. Hammersley flips it through the air, one touch from the go. Is it gonna go? No, a little bit of hop in there. And McLean with Corgoyles comes and gets in his way.
Great block by Erica. She is known as a wall. She's gonna come out of that and try and help Nick out front.
And Corwell is going to lose the ball there. At this level, you're going to have to maintain control. You're going to see so much talent and agility today, and even one missed opportunity like that will turn the game against you. Beautiful pass there, though, from Hammersley. Again, flipping the ball in the air up court. Now, Corgoyles in white trying to get it going. They just keep giving the ball away, though.
They do. They keep losing possession, not finding their man. You really want to be keeping your head up in this game, looking for where your player is going to be, not necessarily where they are, and making the ball get there.
Absolutely. This is bicycle polo, but it's much like hockey in a way that you are circling, you are passing, you're playing to the space. And right there, you see the pass came through to the space. Miguel was facing backwards, but that was fine. He tried the one-timer shot. Didn't work out for him that time, though.
Well, Erica loves taking what she likes to call the block and shock, blocks the ball, takes a long shot. Oh
but here Hammersley's gonna get nice little touch to the outside, and he's gonna find that. As you saw, the Corgoyles in white, they tried to play three up, and it worked against them. The moment the ball turned over, they took advantage, and Chris Hammersley in the blue there just had that one touch on the outside. So now here's Erica Compton of the Corgoyles coming up, but her pass isn't going to go, and possession goes right back to blue.
Again, maintaining possession in this game is so essential, because you're just going to give them the opportunity to come down court.
And you can see how quickly there your opportunities change. Right there, it went from one side to another in seconds. You cannot overcommit. You've got to watch that net. And as a three-on-three team sport, you have to work together. There are no dedicated goalies in this sport. And as you see there, they're going to pass it all the way back to kind of reset. So they'll collect it back behind their own goal line. Goal line's in yellow at the very back. Passes forward, split shots coming up the court.
Chris trying for that nice little crossover shot again. Doesn't have the opportunity in that time.
He comes around. Fake shot there. Look at that. As you see him slapping his mallet to the court, sort of a little fake. Is he shooting, is he not? Doesn't work out there, though. He can't find his teammate. So now the Corgoyles are going to collect it in the back, and now here comes Sterling Quinn up the center. Passes over to his teammate, Steven. A couple of young guns from Seattle that have been playing only a few years together, but already at the upper echelon of the sport, using their youth and agility to their advantage.
We can say that due to the fact that they are in Seattle, one of the better and most well-known clubs in the world, they do get quite a bit of opportunity to excel in their abilities based on who is playing all around them.
And who we're going to have a change for the split shots. You saw Miguel is going to come off, and here comes Delgado in. Delgado is going to go out to the left side. Trivor, not enough English on that shot, though. Now they're going to pass back, and here comes Sterling. Nope, split shots take it right back.
Even if Delgado, actually the only person here from Florida, representing all of Florida here today at our professional hardcourt bicycle polo tournament.
Again, you are watching the upper echelon of this sport. This tournament is the first of its kind. We have had regional tournaments, local tournaments. We have had 5 world championships. But this is the first time we have separated it out to the professional level. You are watching right now the best of the best in North America.
In North America, that's true. That's very important to note that we have many European and
nice shot there.
And friends all over the globe playing this, but these are the best players in North America.
And you saw a beautiful scoop from Delgado. You saw he flipped it over from behind the goal out front, and actually the ricochet from the core goals almost resulted in an own goal.
Which would count in this sport.
Goals
do count. As long as they originate as a shot, if it goes off of your team, it will still count as a goal.
And their core goals actually had one of the better chances they've had so far. They're just not getting the opportunity. Split shots in blue with all the possession. And right there, Delgado's going to take his shot with the open goal, but blocked immediately. Now here comes Andrew up the court. He's going to slap shot from the right side. That goes wide left.
Very wide left. Sterling is now, Sterling and Coyo and Steven on the court. It's interesting to note that this is one of their qualifying teams. These three play together quite often. They play qualifying tournaments together all of the time, and so they should have some really nice chemistry on the court. We're looking to see some great passing and some great plays.
We really do. Yeah, right there. So Andrew is going to foot down, so he has to go back to center court to tap in. That's going to give the core goals a momentary opportunity, but Andrew is already right back in the mix.
Yes.
Coyo with an opportunity in front of the goal. They're coming out. Nice little pivot there from Steven. Coyo going to take it around, trying to find his teammates. Notice that they're playing 3 up, and it gives the opportunity for Hammersley to try a ricochet shot.
Unfortunately, that ball goes out of play, and once again, because it went out on Chris Hammersley Mallet, the possession will go to the Corgoyle.
Corgoyle is here, really a story of up-and-comers that have just been absolutely slain the past few years. Coyo, I believe, was the MVP at literally every tournament he played last year?
Every tournament in 2014 that he was a part of, he was nominated and made MVP.
Yeah,
most valuable player.
You will see a lot of finesse and agility from Coyo, number 13 there, with the long hair. But unfortunately, his team is still down, so he needs to break it out right now.
So I really want to see these guys put something together. You know, it's early on in the day. You'll notice that as the teams start warming up, the plays and the passes and everything will start to get tighter and tighter and tighter. Right now, these guys are just feeling it all out.
You saw Sterling there settle it out of the air. Got to be able to play not only on both sides of your bike, but with that space on the court and in the air. Trying to use it there, not going to go for Stuyvesant. Stuyvesant's going to lose the ball, and it looks like split shots in blue are going to take it over. Hammersley using the goal there to his advantage, trying to create that space.
Yeah, very strategic play. If you're in the lead and you want to calm it down, just bring it back, keep possession, slow down the gameplay, make it your game.
Exactly. And right now, split shots are doing that. They are controlling the game. Chris Hammersley with the ball right now, very much a player of control. But right, he's going to lose it right there. Stuyvesant steals, nice little shoulder. Delgado gets an opportunity. And he's going to foot down.
So now
Court Royals, they turn it around. He's got a shot. Goes wide to the right. Looks like Delgado's bicycle broke, actually. He's having an issue, and you notice he's having to run it off the court. So now Andrew's going to come in. Sort of a power play opportunity for the Court Royals, but split shots are back to full strength.
And it is interesting to note, in this format they're playing, there are three players on the court, but there are two other players on their squad. If there is a situation where you have to foot down and dab in, you can fully exit the court and have another player substitute you right away.
Yeah, more like hockey, but instead of jumping over the boards, we just use the doors. Now, the Court Royals out of Seattle still trying to make something happen. Stuyvesant in the corner. Got to get out in front to score. He circles wide with his teammate behind. They're going to play three up here, circling back. Notice going both directions there. He has an opportunity. He's going to take the shot. So that's stopped by Andrew.
Very important. Andrew is playing goal, but there is not necessarily a standard goalie in bicycle polo.
No, there's
most
not.
Players will rotate through all positions and maybe favor being a stronger forward or a stronger defensive player, but they just don't want to leave that goal open for an opportunity to score.
Exactly. This is a team sport, and in this you have to play all roles in there. Coyo's going to get another opportunity. Right, you can see how quickly fortunes turn, and that shot's going to go wide. Took that three-quarter court shot just because he knew they weren't in goal. Corgoyle's here playing with their core team, three up, trying to put that pressure on.
There we go. That's what we like to see. Really nice passing setup.
There we go.
For the players.
Nice block. He's gonna have an outside shot, but split shot's controlling the center there.
The split defensive play right now is excellent. They are not giving the Corgoyle's any real opportunities to get that to the net.
No, they're not. And like we said, it is a game of possession, control, space, and Hammersley with a beautiful slap shot. Looked like it hit the leg of the goalie there. And now Court Royals with their own slap shot, wide to the right. Got to put him on goal. You can see right now the speed of the play, how quickly the ball goes from one side to another, and you got to be ready.
And also a very fast player.
You can see the players angling not just for the bottoms of the goal, but looking at that top shelf, trying to put it in those corners. It's no accident that they're putting that lift on. They know that there's more space above the wheels, and so they're angling for it.
A little jam up in the corner down over there with Hammersley and Coyo. We're gonna spread it out.
Corgoyle's putting the pressure on. You notice they're not giving them their half of the court. They're challenging at every moment, and it works out there. They're able to turn. Now we have some numbers. It looks like they're going to have a player change for split shots. They collect themselves, and here they come up. You can see, though, split shots in blue, just controlling that center.
Don't want to give them any opportunity. Tiffany sitting in goal there. You can tell. So this is a little unique in this situation. Tiffany is the only one that has covers on her wheels, and those are called wheel guards. Those are going to protect your spokes in situations where the ball is just going straight at the wheels.
And that is, Tiffany is known as one of the better goalies. I have personally played against her hundreds of times, and you can just not get it in on her.
No, she is a wall.
So it looks like we had a penalty there on split shots, and control is going to go back to the Corgoyles. They mount their offensive here, going up. Gonna try a little bit of an outside shot there from the left, not gonna work. Teammate tries to collect it in the corner. You see them hopping to stay up, Miguel on his feet still. Coyo circles around, a little bit of bump and go in front of the goal there, but Tiffany is able to stay up too, rearrange herself.
You notice them hopping around.
Oh, and there, beautiful pass from McLean to Coyo. They're gonna find that corner.
The motivation for them is good right now. Actually, that goal went in just in the triangle behind Tiffany's wheel, and that is because the goals are actually 6 feet wide, which is slightly longer than the standard bike on 700. See wheels.
Yeah, you gotta pick and choose when you're in the goal line. Right there, Tiffany maybe should have closed off the back door. Yep. Four goals, get one in.
Switch on keeping possession. Andrew from Texas playing with Miguel from Texas, the captain of their team, and Tiffany acting as their wall and defensive back. Andrew's gonna keep pushing, but there are two people with him. It is quite difficult to get that ball through to other players.
It is. You'll see, actually, a lot of people say in the European style of stacking multiple players in front of the goal, but right there, as you can tell, they did not cover that goal, and that gamble worked out for the Corvoils. So we're going to equalize it there at 2-2.
That's it. All right, Miguel's nice and slow, gonna take it easy, looking for Delgado on the other side, just wasn't in position.
And there, a little bit of shoulder on the boards.
Something to note about that, there are no penalty calls for shoulder to shoulder. That is a legal play.
Oh no! Yeah, this bicycle polo is a physical sport. Now, nothing dirty, but there's nothing wrong with some shoulder-to-shoulder checking that you start right there against the boards.
We'll see a lot of that. A lot of the players will use each other to try and push each other around a little bit without infraction.
And Delgado there putting a little pressure on the Corvoils, but Corvoils in white able to collect it. Going to reset, pass forward.
Coyo's really looking to turn the energy around for the Corvoils right now.
And he does. What you were saying. You know, at the beginning, the split shots were controlling the pace of the game, but I think we've seen three quick goals from the Corvoils in the past few minutes. And the split shots know it. They're going to call a timeout.
Interesting start to this game. I really feel that there was the opportunities for the split shots to keep that momentum and keep it going, and they kind of got a little too relaxed.
They did. I think the line changes for the Corvoils really helped. Once Coyo came in and they went to that core line of the Seattle Young Guns, that's when we saw the goals.
Yep, that motivation changed right over for the Corvoils. They're going to try and keep that going once this timeout is over. Interesting note, you can have two timeouts per game, and I believe they are only 2 minutes long.
They are, and so you can see right there, the whole game, split shots, the team in blue had been controlling the pace. But then, once things got out of hand, they decided to call stop. And we'll see if they have any line changes here, because who you're playing and who you're defending with, it depends.
It's going to make a difference. I think we're going to get back into this game.
All right. And getting back to it, split shots are going to control the ball and immediately lose it. It has been the story so far. Coyo is going to get another shot there. That's not going to work out entirely.
Coyo's going to keep this motivation going for his team. He really, although he hails Erica as their captain, they really are a unified team, and he wants to keep them going, keep them the pressure on.
And beautiful pass to his teammate right there, predicting where he's going to go. Ooh, the ball hopping a little too much. You saw he was trying to cross over there. Now he's going to flip it to the outside. Corvoils circling like a bunch of sharks up top, but the split shots are holding down the center still.
Yeah, I think McLean just looking, riding around all the way around, looking for that triangle effect of the Corvoils, spreading themselves out, but always giving themselves an opportunity to have a pass back or a pass across. Exactly like that.
Exactly. And Stuyven's going to take a shot. Coyo of the Corvoils will collect it. Now he'll 1-on-3, he's going to take them all on the sides, maybe not. Probably wasn't the best idea there, probably should have settled it back to his teammates, but You gotta take risks. Oh, and right there, that's gonna work. You saw him shooting from behind the goal, ball bouncing around like a pinball a little bit, but went on the inside of the wheel and
Yep, that's what we call an own goal there. It actually deflected off of Miguel's front wheel and actually went into their own goal.
Unfortunate, but that puts Corbales up 4-2. Split shots really need to get some momentum back here. There's a beautiful pass. We got the one-on-one. Hammersley in front of the goal. What's he gonna do? Oh, beautiful shot. He was patient with that, and while he could have just tapped it in, he waited and he put the extra lift on it to guarantee the goal.
Guaranteeing that goal.
So now we have Corboyles, the lead is only one. Corboyles still playing, 3 minutes up, and almost got a nice shot there, but a nice little sort of wheelie to kick the ball out from split shots.
What is the agility of these players on their bikes? So many Absolutely. Of them are hopping around, pivoting around, lifting their wheel, letting the ball pass through so that it doesn't block a shot by their teammate.
Oh, and look, there's a nice lift from McLean using his mallet to scoop the ball through the air. Yeah, you see that agility and that finesse with the bike control, but also you're playing one-handed with a mallet, and some of these guys can do some amazing things with that too.
And the split shots are going to take that steal. Hammersley, the goal scorer,
one
for the
out
shots
front.
Right now.
Oh.
Almost even got that deflection and another shot opportunity.
As you saw, the Corvo player had to pivot and try to defend from out in front of the goal, and it worked for him because that was a very dangerous opportunity. Oh, looks like Miguel's going to foot down. Yes.
I believe that was a penalty.
Yep, on the Corvo's
side.
Ball is going to come back. So, like you said, bicycle polo is a physical sport. You will see a lot of the bump and grind, but can't do it from behind.
Okay. Yeah. It's fine. It's stay a little
nod.
Yeah,
don't
edit that out.
Yeah,
edit that out.
That
yeah
way.
Of course you didn't.
No, I kid. All right, and he goes back to Delgado.
McLean is trying to free his mallet there. So again, with the contact of this sport, mallet to mallet, bike to bike, and body to body. Body to body in the way that it is equal part to equal part, which is why there was that penalty, because Miguel was slightly pushed from behind as opposed to it being shoulder to shoulder and even.
Yeah, and the nice shot from Coyo. The rules of this sport used to be a little more simple. You used to just keep it to that. And while the sport has grown drastically in the past 5 years, we've also refined that contact.
Definitely refined. Yes, because there's a lot of gray areas when you have an open book like that. Right now we're trying to make sure that we are playing the safest way possible for all players, but with also the most opportunities and the most exciting way to play bike polo.
Absolutely, and at this level we want to see skill, and I think that's what we've been seeing so far. Bicycle polo, it can be rough. I have experienced that myself, as I'm sure you have, but at this level you see like that fake right there from Stuyven. They're using skill over physicality right now. Corboyles up 4-3, looking for another one to cut that lead even more, but split shots are gonna take it back. Here they come up the side, looking to pass to the center, but not enough momentum. Here come Corboyles again, got a big away. That shot's gonna go wide to the left.
You can see that Chris there was really disappointed he didn't make that pass.
Oh! But Corboyles is able to bring it right back. Fortunes can turn so quickly. Right there, I thought the split shots were able to mount another offensive, but Coyle stole the ball, immediately put it in the back of the net.
Split shots have brought Tiffany back into the game. I feel as though they may be doing that to have a nice confidence in the defensive. She's a great forward player playing forward right now, but.
Oh, and like, yeah, the beautiful pass from her to Delgado. He gets the shot, but all of a sudden, danger, danger. Breakaway for the Corboyles. Oh, and Coyo with a behind-the-back shot, trying to fake out the experienced player, Chris Hammersley. Didn't work there, but that's the finesse we were talking about that has won him so many MVPs in the past year. Now there's a hop from McLean.
McLean is down. Right now there is the advantage to the split shots. Tiffany's still with the ball there. They're not going to give her any room whatsoever.
And it looks like they were calling the penalty. They gave him advantage on the play. And the ball is going to come back over. So the penalty on the Corvals, you saw as McLean went down, he was trying to tap back in, but they allowed split shots to maintain advantage. Much like soccer, you can commit the penalty, but if you still have the ball and have a scoring opportunity, they'll give you that opportunity.
Oh yeah, the advantage ends when you score or when the other team touches the ball.
So now, here comes split shot. See outside, they have the 2-on-1. What's he gonna do? Oh, a little bit of a missed shot there, and a beautiful pass off the wall for the Corvals. They have a chance, but no, Delgado is right there. Say no to that.
Simon on the court now with McLean, and Coyo's just taking rips all day long. Nope, can't use that.
And a nice flip up in the air. It's going to go over. And you see McLean using his wheel to kick it back out. Corvals, oh, got their pocket picked.
Need to convert this into a goal and just can't do it.
Yeah, split shots really need, you know, a quick goal would work out, but I think they'll take what they can get at the moment. Hammersy trying to maintain that control.
Passing forward, beautiful.
Oh, and looks like Delgado lifted it to himself. They'll put it back to Hammersley, and it goes off the post. Heartbreaking for them because they really need it right now. Here come the Corvals in the corner. Good drop to Stuyven. Corvals, even though they have the lead right now, putting the pressure up on split shots in blue. Nice little wheelie pivot there from Coyo to get his positioning. He gets the pass, goes to the outside, and it's not gonna go.
Oh, they're still down in the defense, in their defensive side.
Yes, split shots just can't seem to get it back just yet. So again, Corvals able to maintain.
Oh, Delgado gets it. But there's just a little bit, the ball is moving quite fast. It's important to note that these balls are designed specifically for bicycle polo at this temperature. It is the most ideal condition for bicycle polo right now. The ball, it should have quite a bit of movement and quite a bit of pop and bounce.
Absolutely. And we're seeing that with some of these ricochet shots and a lot of the lift and bounce we've seen. But I like seeing it. That's what makes this sport so exciting.
So, 100%.
So there, Hammersley's gonna...
Chris, using a classic move of his to sort of scoop the ball up with his mallet and bring it in front of his wheel.
So 5 minutes left on the clock. Split shot's really needing something. Delgado trying to make it happen, but Corvals just really, the pace has changed here in the second half, and Corvals are now the ones in absolute control.
Yeah, feeling nice and easy. This is the beautiful part about bike polo,
beautiful
is when
pass.
You can make these plays happen, you make this passing happen at the speed that they're going and make it look effortless.
And there's beautiful ricochet shot from Hammersley. You could see the goalie was out, and he tried to shoot off the wall from three-quarter courts out. I mean, that is pretty. I like seeing that. At this point in the game, with only a few minutes left, split shots are needing to pull out every trick.
Deep pass down to McLean, but he just can't convert. Tiffany's going to come out of goal, take possession, but Nick is not going to give her any room on that.
Yeah, Corvals able to, even though they're up, they're still using that speed and that passing, and they have been connecting, so why not keep trying? They're a nice pass, but it's just a missed shot.
Missed shot, missed opportunity. Split shot's really looking for it there. Oh, and then...
You could see that, yeah. Coyo came right around Delgado to steal the ball. I thought split shots were going to, you know, mount an offensive right there, but Coyo just came right around the corner and took the ball.
It's about reading those plays.
It is.
Reading that pass and reading those plays and watching to see where they're going to try and put the ball and getting in the middle of it, intercepting and converting it to a possession for yourself.
And you can see Delgado with the split shots using his speed to create an opportunity, but he had no teammates there. This is a team sport. You can't do it alone. But Coyo's gonna try and do it alone right there. 1-on-3, good shot, but an even better block by Tiff.
Okay.
Now McLean's gonna try his hand at it, circling around front, and he gets that outside shot. Oh, beautiful. You could see the momentary absence of the goalie.
Momentary absence. Hammersley was getting into position, just didn't get there quickly, and Nick sees the open goal and takes it.
Beautiful outside shot. Nick McLean, actually from Halifax, one of two Canadians in this tournament.
Well, but, he was born in Halifax, Then his family moved to Ohio. He actually started playing bicycle polo in Lexington, Kentucky.
I own one of those hotbeds of polo, but right there, unfortunately, one of the other Lexington, Kentucky players, Tiff, is not able to prevent that own goal. So here, Swiss Shots immediately trying to get one in. They know the clock is ticking down and they want another one. Warhol's not letting them have it though. Now they are able to get it back now.
Andrew with fresh legs on the court here for the Swiss Shots. We haven't seen him out here for a minute.
Yeah, I think that's smart. You need those fresh legs with 2 minutes left. We have a
full line change.
Miguel is also now in goal.
Oh, definitely.
And so we're being down with so little time left, I think they want to just, they got all their long shots out there right now, you could say.
Yep. They need to make this happen for them on their side.
And there we go. Hammersley is going to get it off the wall.
He's looking up.
Puts it to the center. Miguel has a chance. Touches it towards the goal, but a little too soft. Cordero is able to slow that one down. Now here, the opportunities change so quickly. One pass over the court, and McLean is able to claim another for the Cordero's.
Phenomenal style of play.
And it looks like we're going to have a timeout from Tiffany of the Split Shots. Split Shots in the remaining minutes here definitely need to come together as a team and really make some offense happen. Cordero's at 8-3, clearly in control. And Split Shots, I'm not sure if they just need an extra breath or need to find some strategy, but hopefully they'll find it soon. The Cordero's of Seattle clearly in control as the Split Shots catch their breath. Clock winding down here, and it looks like the team in red and white from Seattle is probably going to pull this one out. Split lanes, now playing three up. Hammersley trying to make a move that instantly gets caught up. Cordero's coming down the left side, pass to the center, try and get one off, but the goalie blocks it out there. The referee sounds 1 minute remaining, and Cordero's, Erica Compton, they're still trying to get one in, even though they're up by five. Now here comes Split Lanes again. Gonna look to the center, look to the outside. Here comes Hammersley around. He's gonna have to chase it back to his own side. 30 seconds left. You can hear the echo here at the Topeka Convention Center. And it's going to be all quiet here as the Cordero's of Seattle wrap it up. A little bit of hopping along the wall. Some stick play trying to get the control of the ball. Not going to happen, though. One last little chance in front of the goal.
All right, I'm here with Miguel from the Split Shots. How'd you feel about that last game?
Could have went a little better, but I think we did okay for not being able, you know, to practice with each other or anything. So.
Yeah, tell me that. Tell me about your team dynamic. What's going on exactly with your team?
Well, it's two people from Lexington, one from Florida, and then two of us from Texas. So I felt that they were good enough players that I wanted to play with, that I always wanted to play with. So And I hit him up, and I wanted to get a team together, and we got a team going. So,
how'd you guys play together yesterday? I know Tiffany looked like multiple times in the game she was holding it together, really putting some moves on some people. How'd you guys feel yesterday?
Yesterday was basically finding out one another's game and how well we did together as a team, since, you know, we're from different areas, and we're just trying to get the groove, you know, of playing together as a team.
What's it like playing the Core Boils? Were there any difficulties playing against them? I know they, you know, they're playing together all the time.
I mean, that's one thing. You know, you have basically all of these teams. They're all one city, and they all play together. So, you know, they know each other's game pretty well. We were still trying to get it together, and I mean, I feel we did pretty good. But yeah.
So I noticed you had an open shot, long shot, from right in front of the goal, and I knew you wanted to take it. I've played you before. I was watching. Why didn't you take that shot?
I just felt that it wasn't on. I just, the ball wasn't in the right place for me to take it.
Okay. Any regrets?
Yeah. I just took it. I just felt like my mallet, the ball was too close to my wheel. I probably would have took myself out, but the ball probably would have been down the court anyway to get in. But it's always next time.
And I've played you multiple times, and I know you to be one of those people who will dive off the bike to save a goal.
Yeah.
I didn't see any of that in this game. What's that about?
Just didn't feel like it.
All right, thanks, Miguel.
All right.
Hey, I'm Shiny Groom, founder of Fixed Craft Polo Equipment, with a little more about the bikes you're seeing on the court today. Now, when it comes to polo bikes, Fixed Craft has a quick and easy rule of thumb to help you figure out what you need. It's real easy. Good, better, best, and custom. A good bike to play on is any bike you can safely stop. Easy. So get out there, we want to see you on the court. A better bike is one like this. A single speed fixie style bike with one lever that stops both brakes and a modified gear ratio to your specs. Normally you want a low ratio that's easy to start, since polo is a lot of stop and go. Most bikes don't need anything more than a dual pull like this one we make to get both brakes working on one hand. You want to stop your bike with one hand because you have a mallet in the other. Just feed both lines into one lever and you're done. You can get a complete bike setup like this for around $300, cheaper if you find a second hand. The best bike for a competitive play is one that is designed for hardcore bike polo and backed by the company that makes it. There are several to choose from, and there are companies that make these in the States, Australia, Germany, and even Peru. This one here pictured is one that Fixed Craft is releasing later this summer. Bikes like these are designed with input from some of the world's best players in an effort to make a universally nimble but stable experience for all sorts of players. These bikes come as frame and fork sets, and players pick out every one of their components carefully to give them every advantage on the court. When you get to this level of bike, the wheels and hubs are incredibly important too. Velocity rims are the go-to for higher quality builds, like on this one, paired with Fixed Craft high-end hubs. A setup like this is going to be a little over $1,000, depending on the components you pick out. That leaves us with our last category, and that's custom. Nothing made on a production line, whether that's a pair of shoes or a suit, will be as amazing as something tailor-made to your individual dimensions. The same goes for bike frames as well. When you get to the pro level play like you're seeing today, this is where you'll see more custom frames made specifically to the players' bodies. These are the highest quality, handmade bikes in the world, made one at a time, and sometimes they are one of a kind. It's not unusual to see custom setups that run in the $3,000 range. Well, that's it for Hardcore Bike Polo Bikes, and don't forget to go to leagueofbikepolo.com and see where clubs are playing near you. Get your bike, and we'll see you on the court. No excuses.